Dave Rowntree of Blur actually thought this was an acceptable way of treating a human being. The rest of Blur just stood around laughing while their drummer tormented this interviewer.
Let's just look into the history here of Blur for Damon. Let's look into the history of Blur for a second, shall we?
Okay.
What the history of Blur is, Alex, where did you guys go to school? Where did you guys go to school?
I went to Stanway Comprehensive.
But where did you go to school, Alex?
I went to Bournemouth School.
Hey, Dave, I'm wearing a t-shirt. Oh, wait a second, Dave. Dave, I'm wearing a t-shirt right now. I'm wearing a t-shirt right now. And some people are saying I'm wearing a Blur or Shite shirt. But am I wearing a Blur or Shite shirt, Dave, of Blur? Dave, am I? Do you think I am wearing a Blur or Shite shirt?
No.
No, I'm not. Because I love Blur. And I wanted to acknowledge you guys by saying first, right off the bat, what shirt am I wearing?
A Goldsmiths. Well, there you go.
School.
Yes.
Lewisham, SC14.
Yes, now you went to school here.
That's college, really. We call that college.
And did you go to school here at all, Damon?
No, I enrolled in a part-time music course to give me entrance to the Union Bar.
I was wondering about that, because what I was trying to get at with Dave is Dave didn't go to that school, because you did kind of go to the school, didn't you?
Well, I drank a lot there, but Dave drank there as well, you know?
But he didn't go to school there, and maybe that's why he's acting in that way. Do you think that's why he's acting in that way there, Alex?
I think he just doesn't like you very much.
So, Calm, what is the traits of Dave that makes him got that fire in his belly?
Well, you know, he's not always like that. He's obviously bring out a certain side to him, which I have to say I find rather attractive.
Graham Coxton, the guitarist, shortly left, and in 2003, Blur were put to bed.
One big question remains. Our editor would like to know who you think was better, you lot or Oasis.
Well, that's not a very grown-up question for Newsnight, is it?
I'll pass that on.
I think Oasis were better.
Do you?
Yeah,
you
I do. I think they were better at communicating who they were than we were.
So there you go, folks. Oasis are better. In 1993, Radiohead came onto the scene. They had their first top 10 hit with Creep that hit number 7 in the charts. They've had 6 UK number 1 albums and 7 UK top 10 singles, with songs like Paranoid Android, Karma Police, No Surprises, and Street Spirit Fade Out. The early 90s would see a rise of bands like The Verve. They had their first top 10 hit in 1997 with Bittersweet Symphony, which hit number 2 in the singles chart, then followed by a number 1 with The Drugs Don't Work. Acts like Stereophonics broke through, Supergrass, and many more. In fact, there's an advert here that might help you remember.
What do you call an album with all your favourite bands on it? The Dogs album! The Manics, Space, Oasis, Supergrass, and all that lot. Apparently, what they've done right is nicked all the best tunes from this year, 40 of them, and stuck them all on one record. Is that allowed? I mean, it's not fair on all the others, is it? In a room, there's no other faces. Don't get stuck with the Dogs' dinner. Get the Dogs' album.
UK bands were on the rise again. They were breaking the charts with only competition from these awful TV talent shows. And as we were approaching a new decade, the landscape of music as a whole was changing. The 2000s had arrived. Everything was going a bit more modern. The internet was now accessible. And there was introductions to many new acts, such as Muse, Coldplay, The Cause, and Feeder. they had their first top 10 hit with Buck Rogers that hit number 5 in the charts in 2001. Overall, they've had 9 UK top 10s and 11 UK top 40s. In that same year, Gorillaz released their first album. Their first two hits made it into the top 10, with Clint Eastwood hitting number 4 in the charts and 19-2000 hitting number 6 in the charts. The second album, on the other hand, only got to 65 in the charts. Oasis also had their fair share of hits around this point. They released two albums in the year 2000, one being Standing on the Shoulder of Giants, and the other one being Familiar to Millions. They had a number one hit with their first single, Go Let It Out, followed by two number four hit singles with Who Feels Love and Sunday Morning Call, followed by another number one hit with The Hindu Times, followed by Stop Crying Your Heart Out, which hit number two in the charts, followed by Little by Little, which hit number two in the charts, followed by Songbird, which hit number three in the charts. Followed by, actually, I'll mention another band now, The Darkness! Yeah, they also had hits. And Busted, and McFly, and all those sort of bands. Well, pop bands. But still not as authentic as Travis, who you can tell are British by the way they sound. And a band that's worked and worked to get where they are. They're not just bought in. A lot of bands these days seem to have rich parents that had rich parents that had rich parents. And you see what I mean? Like, the nepotism is disgusting. I'm surprised we can't sort it out in a country like this. But anyway, but Travis had their first top 10 hit in 1999 with Why Does It Always Rain On Me, followed by another four top 10 hits. On the 20th of December 2003, Ozzy Osbourne and his daughter Kelly had a number one hit with the Black Sabbath song Changes. It was very sudden and came out of nowhere, but it proved that heavy metal gods can still break the charts in the early 2000s. The Streets was another band to come out of the early 2000s. In 2004, they had two top 10 hits with Dry Your Eyes and Fit But You Know It. But all in all, there weren't many bands that charted in 2003 or 4. But there was one band that year that helped the paradigm shift. On the 28th of February 2004, Keane released Somewhere Only We Know, which peaked at number 3 in the charts. Their album Hopes and Fears went to number 1 in the charts and stayed there for 5 weeks, making way for The Scene with No Name, which brought new indie acts to the forefront of the party. Franz Ferdinand hit the UK number 3 spot with Take Me Out, causing their self-titled album to also peak at number 3 in the album charts. Even pop artists at the time were trying to copy off the indie look. Signs of the industry jumping on the bandwagon were starting to show. In 2005, there was a return from Damon Albarn with Gorillaz, appealing over to the US market as well, and featuring American artists and intertwining hip-hop with Britpop, hitting a number 2 spot with Feel Good Inc. and Dare, which hit the number 1 spot. Razorlight had their first top 10 in 2004 with Golden Touch, which hit number 9 in the UK charts. And then a year later, they hit the number 2 spot with Somewhere Else. And then in 2006, their self-titled album peaked at number 1 in the charts. Their first single, In the Morning, peaked at number 3 in the charts. But then they hit the number 1 spot with America. The Arctic Monkeys was another 2005 band that charted everywhere, peaking at number 1 in the charts for Bet You Look Good in a Dance Floor. And from the Welsh village of Quellammunnam, returned Stereophonics And on the 12th of March 2005, they had their first UK number one with Dakota. All in all, they've had 26 UK top 40s and 11 UK top 10s. Most of their albums have also hit number one in the UK charts. Oasis came back with an album in 2005 entitled Don't Believe the Truth. Their first single from the album, Lila, went straight to number one in the charts. Oasis's reign on the charts didn't end there. They had another number one, with The Importance of Being Idle, being the first Oasis video to feature somebody else lip-syncing, and being the centre stage, and having the band members being in the background. Noel wrote the lyrics with an apathetic outlook on life, strung out in a hotel on cocaine and other drugs. Rhys Ifans dances into a funeral director's and gets measured up for his funeral. Oasis have had 8 UK number 1 singles, 23 UK top 10 singles, and 26 UK top 40 singles. With that, they have had 8 UK number 1 albums, 11 UK top 10 albums, 30 UK top 40 albums. From 2009, Oasis sold over 75 million records worldwide, making them one of the best-selling bands of all time. Straight from the grimy streets of Leeds came Kaiser Chiefs. They broke into the charts in 2004 and had a number 6 hit with Oh My God, shortly followed by hitting a number 9 spot with I Predict a Riot, and a number 10 with Every Day I Love You Less and Less. They had a number 11 hit with Modern Way. Their 2005 album, Employment, peaked at number 2 in the UK charts, and it stayed there for 101 weeks, spilling over into the very next year. Their album received a British Ivor Novello Award, and then they received 3 Brit Awards on the same night.
And the winners are Kaiser Chiefs.
And then they won another one.
The nominees are...
The nominations for British Group are... Coldplay.
And the winner is Kaiser Chiefs.
And another one.
And the nominees are Oasis. Kaiser Chiefs.
Kaiser Chiefs.
Hi. I think Metallica should have won it.
Who is this guy?
Well, I've got my own award, and it's better than that, and I love it. Get in there.
All right. We don't know who that is.
That's Manx for you.
Thanks, Mick. Thanks, James. Thanks, Mark and Martin. And I'm going to say bye.
This means the world.
There's no label that unites these bands. Franz Ferdinand, Dogstein, Hot Cars, Kaiser Chiefs, Razorlight, The Libertines, The Zootons,
Block Party,
Futureheads. They're all there in the new British bands, but there's not one scene that, not one label that covers it, which is good, and it means that all these bands have a much greater chance of longevity. If they called it Britskank. Right, then Britskank. And everyone's going, Britskank. I love Britskank, me. And all fires on all clubs would say, playing indie, new wave and Britskank. And then Talk everyone would get really pissed off with Britskank. I hope no one actually puts Britskank on any front covers of any magazines.
It's rubbish. I'm dead against it. It's over. Britskank's finished.
The new wave of indie bands was taking off. Coldplay made a comeback with Speed of Sound, which hit number 2 in the charts, shortly followed by Fix You, which hit number 4 in the charts, and Talk, which went to number 10, causing their 2005 album X and Y to hit the number 1 spot in the UK charts, helping to fuel this new indie scene. Groups that would otherwise be considered as pop were starting to change up their sound in order to fit in. While being an admirable move from some fans, you could also argue that they were just jumping on the bandwagon. The Kooks were another indie band that have had 10 UK top 40s and 3 UK top 10s, most notably known by their songs Naive and She Moves in Her Own Way. Snow Patrol also had their first UK top 10 in 2004 with the song Run, which hit number 5 in the charts. Then in 2006, they released You're All I Have, which went to number 7, and then Chasing Cars, which hit number 6 in the charts, causing their 2006 album, Eyes Open, to chart at number 1. The Automatic was another band to make it into the charts. They hit the number 6 spot with their song Monster, causing their 2006 album, Not Accepted Anywhere, to peak at number 3 in the album charts. The Feeling was another band from 2006 that heavily charted. Their first single, Sown, went to number 7 in the charts, followed by Fill My Little World Right Up, which hit the number 10 spot, causing their first two albums to top the charts. 2006 saw the success of the Zootons. They hit the number 9 spot twice with Why Won't You Give Me Your Love and Valerie. They've had 9 UK top 40s, but only 2 UK top 10 hits. Kasabian was another band to chart in 2004. Their first single, Clubfoot, only hit number 19 in the charts, but their self-titled album hit number 4 in the UK album charts. All in all, they've had 12 UK top 40 singles and 4 UK top 10s. The Fratellis also released 2 songs that went to the top 10 in 2006. They released Chelsea Dagger, which hit the number 5 spot, and Whistle for the Choir, which went to number 9, being their only UK top 10 hits. The Ordinary Boys was another band that managed to get into the charts in 2005. They had their first top 10 hit with Boys Will Be Boys, which hit number 3 in the UK charts. In 2006, Muse had a comeback with their album Black Holes and Revelations, which hit number 1 in the UK album charts, being already massively well known with songs like Plug In Baby and Time Is Running Out. They've had 6 UK number 1 albums and 22 songs in the top 40. In 2007, Mika's first single, Grace Kelly, went straight to number 1 in the UK charts, and his first album, Life in Cartoon Motion, peaked at number 1 in the charts too, striking 5 UK top 10 singles. Kaiser Chiefs also hit their first UK number 1 with Ruby. Their 2007 album, Yours Truly Angry Mob, also went straight to number 1 in the UK album charts. They've had 9 UK top 40s and 5 UK top 10s, and have spent 122 weeks in the UK top 40. Becoming one of the biggest bands of 2007. Just Jack also had a massive hit in 2007, bringing a vocal delivery similar to The Streets, fusing ska, club and indie. They released Stars in Their Eyes, which went straight to number 2 in the charts, and it's a long way to come from the dog and dark, but now seem to have faded into obscurity. The Hoosiers were another band to come out of 2007. They immediately hit the number 5 spot with Worried About Ray, shortly followed by hitting the number 4 spot with Goodbye Mr. Ray. Their 2007 album, The Trick to Life, went straight to number one in the charts, causing their popularity to skyrocket. Scouting for Girls was another band to chart in 2007. They had their first UK number one hit with their self-titled album. They've had 7 UK top 40s, but only 1 number one. Klaxons also had their first UK top 10 in 2007. Golden Scans, it hit the number 7 spot. Their 2007 album, Myths of Near Future, hit the number 2 spot in the album chart. Hardfire was another band in the mid-2000s period. They had their first UK top 10 with Hard to Beat, which went to number 9 in the charts, followed by Living for the Weekend, which hit number 15 in the UK charts. They've had 2 UK number 1 albums and 7 UK top 40s. At this point in time, indie bands managed to penetrate the club scene, appealing over to a wider demographic and generally getting played where they wouldn't usually get played. Generally, the bands with a stronger, more punchy sound that got played in the clubs, as they captured the essence of nightlife in the city. The Script are a band from Dublin, Ireland, formed in 2007. They released their self-titled first album in 2008 and it peaked at number one in the charts. Their first single, The Man That Can't Be Moved, went straight to number 2 in the charts. They've now had 5 number 1 albums altogether, 4 UK top 10 singles and 11 UK top 40s. By 2008, we were starting to see a decline in bands reaching the top 10, and the invasion of new bands had begun to slow down. For example, No You Girls, released in 2009, only hit number 22 in the charts, and although their albums did pretty well, their singles never struck the same chord, like in 2014 when the Klaxons released There Is No Other Time and it only went to number 42 in the charts. In 2009 there was more of a resurgence of drum and bass music than anything else. Chasing Status's 2009 song End Credits went to number 9 in the charts. They've had 4 UK top 10s and 8 UK top 40s. The Prodigy also made a comeback in 2009. They released Omen on the 21st of February that year, and it went straight to number 4 in the singles charts. They also released Warriors Dance that year, which hit number 9 in the singles charts. They've had 7 UK number 1 hits and 8 UK top 10s. On the 28th of August 2009, Oasis split up. Noel and Liam went their separate ways. Liam took the rest of Oasis's band members and made BDI, while Noel started a different band called the High Flying Birds. BDI's 2011 album, Different Gear Still Speeding, peaked at number 3 in the album charts, but unfortunately none of their songs made it into the top 10 or the top 20. Which begs the question, if already established well-known acts can't make it into the top 10, who else has a chance? You might be under the impression that the Arctic Monkeys dominated the UK charts, but that's not true. After the year 2007, they only had 1 UK top 10 with Why Do You Only Call Me When You're High. Even though they and other bands at the time were having UK number 1 albums, none of the songs were actually getting into the top 10, or sometimes not even the top 40. For instance, in 2013, Black Sabbath hit the UK number 1 spot with their album, 13. But none of the singles actually made it into the charts. Same thing with Noel Gallagher's High Flying Birds. They only had 4 UK top 40s, no top 10s, and no number 1 hits. Even though they've had 3 UK number 1 albums. With Coldplay being an exception, and still managing to reach the top 10 singles charts. With songs like Paradise, Hymn for the Weekend, and Something Just Like This. Mumford & Sons were another band that came up in 2009. They managed to have 2 UK number 1 albums, but they've only had 5 UK top 40 hits, with no UK top 10s, and obviously no number 1 singles. and the script had their last UK number one hit in 2012 with Hall of Fame, featuring Will.i.am from the Black Eyed Peas. The way things were going, it was starting to look like bands needed to start utilising popular guest features on their songs to get into the top 10. That, or changing up their sound to become more modern. But unfortunately, for some bands, these adjustments didn't pay off. They changed up their sound and released Madness in 2012, but it only hit the number 25 spot. The 1975 are a newer band that came out in 2013. They've had 4 UK number 1 albums, but only 10 top 40s, 0 top 10s, and 0 number 1 singles. Years and Years are a pop dance act that started charting in 2014. They've had 5 UK top 10s and 1 UK number 1 with their 2015 hit, King. Although being nothing like their predecessors, they seem to be one of the only British bands breaking into the mainstream these days. Most of them do play instruments, but their sound would never be described as rock or indie. Unlike Royal Blood, which kept the hard rock sound. Being a newer band and charting in 2014 with their self-titled number one album, Royal Blood, they have had 2 other UK number one albums, but have also had no UK top 40 singles. And even now in 2021, where the charts is oversaturated with pop acts, the radio stations and chart systems in the UK have put up a brick wall against any new bands getting in.
You know, I work at a radio station and I know that we wouldn't touch some of the stuff that I've seen recommended and I've recommended because, you know, we're a multi-million pound business and they like to play it as safe as possible, which, you know, could mean that it all ends before it should have, I don't know. But it's going to be safer on radio, and radio has never been as safe as it is now because it's become a big business and it's you know, more about profit these days than it ever has been. We will play the playlist stuff 99% of the time, and then other times we'll play like 1% of really safe stuff that is new. The DJs will play pretty much what they want within reason, whereas Absolute and all the big national stations outside of Six Music, and I include Radio 1 for the most part in that, the DJs don't really have a say in what they play. I mean, of course, you know, we have a music team and we talk to them on a daily basis and I say, I want to play this or I don't want to play that. And I submit stuff to them all the time. But 90% of the stuff I submitted, if it gets played, it won't be played in my show. So Absolute has 2 million listeners a week. And if we put on a random new band that are like a very niche band, 100 people in those 2 million might love it, but then 500,000 might turn off, and that's the thing they worry about.
With attitudes like that, it's no wonder we have no new UK bands. If radio DJs can't even change the system from the outside in, then who can? It's sad that UK bands just can't make it big anymore. And it's also sadly down to the fact that there are hardly any music jobs anymore in this country, with most of them being down in London, which begs the question, how many talent scouts are really out there looking for you? The state of music today has really gone down the pan, where solo artists like Ed Sheeran is considered the best that Britain has. Or, oh, not that Lewis Capaldi fella. So yes, the idea is we need to get back on track to bands. When we used to have legendary acts like Queen and the Beatles, how can we go from that to Ed Sheeran and Lewis Capaldi? It's about time we had a change of scenery anyway. This has been Invasion Network. Non-profit, just going at it like a boss. I hope you enjoyed my documentary. You don't have to subscribe, you can just watch it. I'm not gonna bite your finger off now. Yeah, maybe just stay tuned for the next one. Woo!